Hello there, everyone. This is Magical Main Street Dads. I'm Josh.
I'm Nevin.
And we're back with another episode of our YouTube channel for you. We're going to do something, I think, a little bit different this time around. We're trying to do different things than typical reviews or what to do at the parks. We've gone over a lot of what you can do at the parks. And some of the hidden secret things you can do, the secret trivia and facts that you can look for, you know, on your quest for your hidden Mickeys and stuff, of course. But there's all different things that you can look for. We went over that in great detail in each park, some cool things we found. But now we were thinking over the last week what we're going to do for our next episode. And we thought about, we told you all about things that you can do, things you can find, but there are things that are no longer at Walt Disney World that they took away from us. And we miss them.
Yeah.
Some of these might be not on your list of favorite things that are gone, but these are things that we liked that Disney. Now, Disney has to change with the times. We realize that. And, you know, Nevin and I think we both applaud them and moving forward with doing that as well. But we do miss some things. So it's not a sad episode. It's an episode to reminisce a little bit about, and maybe they'll bring something back in one form or another. They do that. So these are some things. We didn't pick one specific park for this, just things all around. But just a couple things that are no longer at Disney World that we liked. So let's turn this a little bit upbeat. And I feel like we're like being down on this. And it's not. Change is good, people. Embrace it. Because if you keep doing the same thing over and over, why do you want to go back besides the other magical things that are there? But if you keep doing the same thing over and over, got to change it. So, Nevin, like for you to go first with something that you miss at Walt Disney World.
Okay. Well, one good thing about this episode is Josh and I will not have the same ones.
Yeah, I don't think so.
I delve back to me being a kid, the changes from the early 80s. So Josh obviously didn't go to Disney until the 90s. So I got at least a decade on him. So my first one is I'm going to go back to Epcot, and I wrote the dates down because I'm horrible with remembering dates. 1983 is when this one opened. This was sponsored by GE. It's called Horizons. Horizons was an Omnimover. For those of you who don't know what Omnimover is, it's kind of like the Haunted Mansion, the ride. You sit in it. It's kind of like a little ball thing you sit in, and it goes along a track. That's what it does. Horizons was all about the future. So this was in the future area. This was in phase two of Epcot's planning. Now, for Epcot, for those of you who don't know, Walt originally envisioned Epcot as a utopia, self-sufficient place. Horizons was all about that. It was educating us on living in outer space, living underwater, all the technology that's going to be needed. It was great to see that, especially as a kid. It was great to see that because, you know, the future's so bright. Back in 83, computers were not small laptops like you have now. Computers were the size of rooms. That's how big they were. So seeing that technology as a kid really made me think, like, wow. You know, to be honest, as a kid, I thought by now in my life, we'd have some colony on the moon. I thought by now we'd be living on the moon or living underwater. I mean, we do have some hotels where they have rooms underwater now. But, I mean, full on complete living up on the moon and that. But Horizons was great for at the time, the future, the technology. And, again, it was a lot of education. But as a kid, you didn't absorb it as education. You just were like, wow, this is amazing. This ride was replaced in 1999 with one of my favorite, 1999 with one of my favorite rides, replaced by Mission Space.
Very cool. I did not experience Horizons, so, and I believe at Mission Space, there is an homage to Horizons.
Yes.
I think what, like, towards the, in the entrance or something, there you see the symbol for it.
The logo of Horizon. It was almost kind of like a pyramid, kind of squarished off pyramid. So, yes, the Horizons logo is there still.
So, very cool. They still, see, that's the cool thing about Disney, right? They take something away. They put something really cool in its place. So, and they still pay tribute to it. Just like the Winnie the Pooh ride and Mr. Toad. You see Mr. Toad handing off the deed, you know, things like that. So that's the cool thing that Disney does. I like that. Very cool. Very cool. All right. So my first more modern and perhaps the most recent of the taking away of things. And now this is probably a little controversial because people don't like this. I find not a lot of people like it, but the people that do like it are true fans of this type of ride, and those that like this particular ride loved it. And I'm in that camp.
Okay.
A lot of people might have found it boring, repetitive, whatever. I don't think it's repetitive, but I think it's exciting in its own way. And it was a great way to spend some time on a ride without waiting forever. So I'm going to Animal Kingdom and the Primeval World. I see the disappointment in your face. And I will go into why I like this ride, okay, and why it kind of is a shame that it's taken away. Number one, there's now two things you can really do in Dino Land. The Triceratops spin, which only for five and under, really, and Dinosaur. Otherwise, you got a store, you got a meet and greet, the Nevin talked about the Dino Playland that they have there. I go there, nobody plays the games that are there at the Midway Carnival. Nobody does that. It's wide open. It's hot. But Primeval World, you were under shade waiting in line. The line was never long for this ride. And I understand why. It's kind of like, because, hey, it's in Dino Land. But this is...
that sums it up.
If you remember, it's a classic cat and mouse type roller coaster. So there's different levels to it. What I loved about it is the car spins around as you're going, and that lends itself to being almost a different ride each time you go, because you never really knew which way that car was going to spin. Okay. Depending on where you sat in the car, and that held up to like four people, I think it was like four people. But if you had someone who is an adult and a kid, and the way it's going to swing towards where there's more weight with the adult, and the kid gets whipped around, and you go down backwards through little bunny hills. You never knew. Sometimes you go forward. Sometimes you go backwards. Sometimes you go sideways. The unpredictability of it, that's what I liked. Like I said, there was never a line because only true fans really liked it. But I thought it was very well themed for the area because it dealt with dinosaurs. It was about time travel, and it went back to when the meteor hit Earth and the dinosaurs went extinct, and you hear about oil and other things when you're on the ride. Nevin's like, yeah, whatever, I hate this ride. But that thing, you can get on and get off and ride that thing at least four times within 20, 25 minutes at certain parts of the day. And honestly, there was plenty of times where I was like waiting for dinner, and I'm like, what am I going to do? Just sit and sweat? No, let me get on a ride. Dinosaur might have been half an hour. I'm going to be late for my dinner. Might have been 45 minutes. Definitely going to be late for dinner. Expedition to Everest, the lines were a little bit long. It's just something that you can get done. You can get to almost anywhere in that park if you hoof it within 15 minutes anyway. I think a lot of it has to do with we talk about family bonding too. My son and I really bonded over this ride. He loved it. We would laugh the entire time we were on this thing. And my poor mom, like she would get on, like she would ride that at, like maybe two times, and she'd be like, "That's it, I'm done." We would go back on over and over and over. She's like, "No, I'm just done. I'm just can't do it again." The music, the sounds were insane. I'm not gonna, I admit, they're crazy, like TikTok sounds, like they're crazy. It drives you nuts. But overall, it wasn't that bad of a ride. It was fun. I don't think people gave it the chance because of where it was. People kind of walked past it, like, "Eh, what's this?" It was broken down a lot, but there were two tracks there. I think there was like 26 cars total going between the two rides. It moves pretty fast. I found it fun. I loved it. I'm in a camp that loved it, and I just think it's a shame that they're taking more stuff away from that area without a clear picture of what they're doing. I honestly don't think Disney knows what they're doing with that area at this point. They need to either, we talked about before, retheme it or something, but right now I don't think they have a clue. And taking that ride away, maybe it was because of mechanical issues, but I think it's a shame because it did fit the area. It fit that Carnival Midway area because it is a carnival ride. It's a classic carnival ride. So I miss that. There's no replacement for it. It's not going anywhere else. If they put another ride in, what will it be? I don't know. It's not that, excuse me, hard of huge of a footprint either.
Wow.
So they would have to go into another area. They could go elsewhere. They could expand, of course, but that's my first pick.
Okay. Well, there's nothing wrong with it. Actually, what you described it to me, Primeval World is actually two carnival rides in one. You have the Wild Mouse, which is the roller coaster, and the Tilt-A-Whirl as it's spinning uncontrollably and things like that. So it's actually two carnival rides in one. I got bad knees. So the whole snap jerking and all that, I would always bang my knees on Wild Mice rides. So I stay away from that, especially with all the walking I have to do at Magic Kingdom and Disney. I stay away from that for my knees. The grandkids didn't really want to go on it, so I didn't make them go on it. But I know some people who liked it for that whole thing, the unpredictability, the spinning, and things like that. I get it. It's okay.
But that closed this past summer, and it was closed before.
Many times.
For mechanical reasons. The wild thing about that is two employees have died on that ride, working on that ride. One fell from an area that I believe was not an authorized area. I'm not sure, but they. After that happened, they took measures to make sure nobody went up into that area. And someone else was working on the ride and got hit in the head with something, and they unfortunately passed away too. So it does have a little bit of bad juju with it, but so gone but not forgotten to the people and the ride.
Okay. All right. So now I am going to actually stay in Epcot. 1986. The name of this ride is actually very similar to the ride that replaced it. They really didn't do a whole lot of retheming. They just threw a different name on it and added some stuff. This was sponsored by United Technology because back in the day, remember I mentioned Disney had a lot of corporate sponsorships for rides because they didn't have excess amounts of money. This one was sponsored by United Technology. This was Living with the Seas. It's now replaced back in 2005 by Living. I'm sorry, The Seas and Friends with Nemo. That's what it is now. The whole facade really hasn't changed. They just threw some paint on it and just added Nemo and some characters. But the whole concept was you are going to base station Alpha. You get hurtled into this little elevator that really doesn't even go nowhere. But you think you're going down into the ocean. You feel the elevator shaking, and on the side you see bubbles and stuff like that. So you think you're going underwater. Base Station Alpha is supposed to be a port under ocean. It's all about, and again, huge amounts of education in here. Everything was education-based about how we can live undersea. I mean, the aquarium was still there. They just rethemed it a little bit, like, you know, you're looking out into the ocean because you're underwater now. So it was a little darker as far as lighting wise, because as you know, the deeper you go in water, the darker it gets. You're not going to have, you know, unless you're in like 10 feet of water, it's not going to be excessively sunny. So it was all themed towards living underwater. Again, the whole concept to Epcot was, you know, a self-sustaining futuristic feel of, you know, how can humans sustain themselves? And again, it goes back to my childhood of, you know, Horizon, same concept was, you know, we could be living on the moon. We could be living underwater. Here's how we do it. It was a lot of education in there. But as a kid, I didn't see the education. I absorbed the education. I understood what they're talking about, but I didn't see it as education. It was more fun. Like, hey, I'm underwater. Look at this. Look at the shark. Look at the stingray. Look at this. You know, there was a lot of hands-on. It was kind of like a Smithsonian Institute thing where you're at hands-on and you're learning. That's what this ride was all about. So, yeah, living with the seas.
Yeah, that sounds like it's more in tune to what Epcot really is about.
Yes.
Rather than the Nemo ride. Like, the Nemo, I understand they went with it because it was popular. It was a good retheme. It got kids more interested, especially younger kids. But I don't know. A lot of kids love aquariums anyway. I don't think that's really a big issue. But, and I see, like, they got away from that, you know. So you have more cartoony things added in. But that fits so well in the future world section, you know, because, like you said, with Horizons and that, I could see that. And it's more immersive, right?
Yeah.
Then going on the Nemo ride. At Nemo, you're like, oh, I'm going underwater with Nemo. We're going to see his friends. Yeah. Like, I personally don't need that. I'd rather do that living with the sea thing. I wish I experienced that.
That was a great one. I just think because this living with the seas was actually supposed to be part two to a ride in Magic Kingdom. Supposed to be part two to Carousel of Progress.
Okay.
Yeah. Because remember, Carousel of Progress, they were in space type things. Well, this was supposed to be part two. Now we're living underwater. I just think, just like the issues with some people with Carousel of Progress, you hit the future. Okay. Back in the day, those were all modern concepts. Well, now they're past for us.
Yeah.
So I think that's where it lost a lot of luster with the fan base. Okay, we're not living under the ocean. There's no technology that we know of being designed to live under the ocean. So we have to retheme it. They have this huge aquarium. It probably would have cost them more to get rid of the aquarium than just to retheme it and call it Nemo with Friends. But yeah, the facade is still the same. They just added the name and the Nemo characters to the entranceway. And when you're in, after the ride part of Nemo, when you're in there, you'll still see the steampunk type pipings all around. That's the original stuff. They really didn't do much to changing the original ride.
Just kind of made it more enticing, I guess. And
yeah, for the younger crowd.
I'll update it. And so when did this ride start? Like 86, you said?
86.
Yeah, so, you know, the retheme 15 years later plus, you know, 20 years later. I totally get it.
Yeah.
You know, I think it still gets a little bit away from Walt's vision of future world. But especially now, what they're doing there, we could discuss that later. But
Epcot for me is going away from the original vision, which I don't want to say I'm upset about, because I'm really not. I'm kind of curious to see how these new rides and the new vision of Epcot is. But, you know, times change.
It's true. That's right. And with that change, they get rid of things on us.
Yep.
So, all right. Good one. Good one. You are going old school. These are things I have not experienced and I will not experience.
Sadly. I'll guarantee you my number one is one you've never experienced.
No. This one is one that we have experienced. It has been throughout the world at many different parks. Okay. You probably know what I'm going to go with. I don't know. As I describe it, I'm going to read your face and see. I thought you knew right there when I said that. So it's been taken away. It's been brought back. It's been taken away. It's been redone. It is bizarre. Okay. It is quirky. I was skeptical when I heard about it, but I had to see it firsthand. And when I first saw it, I was still like, what am I watching?
What park are you in?
I am going to Magic Kingdom.
Okay.
And I heard about it. I didn't see it the first time. A couple times I was there, and I was just like, I got to check this out. It's just so bizarre. I saw videos. It's weird. And I'm just going to say I didn't like it at first, but then once I kept watching it, I enjoyed it. The Electrical Parade.
You heathen. The Main Street Electrical Parade is awesome. You heathen.
It is awesome, but it's the most bizarre thing I've ever seen, dude. It is crazy. Like, I saw pictures first up. I'm like, this looks really neato. It's really cool. All the lights and everything. Then I watched a video and I was like, whoa, this is out there. So I stopped watching the video because I just wanted a little clip. I'm not a big fan of spoilers in any way, shape, or form. So I try not to do that. So we go, and this must have been 2015, I guess. It was the first time I saw it. And the kid was a little bit younger. I don't know how the kid fell asleep during it, but he did. He was, you know, 7 o'clock in the morning till whatever next shows up at, like, almost 8:30, I think, because it's pretty dark out. And we go in June, so it's later. It is one of the most bizarre, trippy, psychedelic things I've ever seen in my life. I'm a deadhead, and so I like these weird things. It's everything. The lights, the freaky music, I don't know, the atmosphere. It is crazy. The crowd goes wild for this thing. Like, you would think the biggest movie star is walking down Main Street, and I'm like, what is going on here? But I loved it. Yeah. 100%. It's a nighttime thing right before the fireworks. It sets you up. It is great. It's a tradition for almost every family that I know. Like, you lined up. You got your spot. Mm-hmm. And people were, like, cheering, yelling. Woo, they're going crazy. Their characters are out. The best is, like, you see Tinkerbell come out. She's sitting atop there. And just the way everything's recorded. The timing on this was impeccable, where she goes like this with her hand and then goes ting. You know, you hear the tink. You hear the bells. You hear everything when the train from Dumbo comes out. And Goofy's driving, Mickey and Minnie are in there, and you hear voices. It's all choreographed great.
Yeah.
And one of my favorite movies is Alice in Wonderland. And she comes out on top of this, again, trippy mushroom, and she's just sitting on top of it, and the lights and the blinking and the music. I mean, the music, it's just like, it doesn't even fit any of the movies that they're representing, really. It's just like this weird, bizarre music going like this in your head through the speakers. You're just like, what? But you have Cinderella, you got Snow White, Pinocchio, you got the Seven Dwarves in there, a huge Pete's dragon with Pete on top, and it moves, it does things, and he's lip syncing, because you can't hear him really. I think he's lip syncing and he's talking, and but it's awesome. And it's like an 18, 20-minute thing. And as you hear it go by, you hear, what Pete says early on when he first comes out, they have to do it again down the road. So it repeats, and it's any parade when they have the music like that and how it repeats, I always find fascinating how they time it so perfectly. Like they know they have to drive at a certain speed. They have to, they can't dilly-dally. It's all very well done. The freakiest things, though, were the snail and the turtle. Dude, those things, they come out and they like whip around. It's almost like those little go-karts you saw with the Shriners at the parades, and they do those things. They whip around. These things will come up kind of close to the edge of the sidewalk and whip around. And I swear these things were looking at me. So that unfortunately went away, I guess, what, 2016-ish or so. They did bring it back in 2019 for a very limited run. I believe there are other parks that do have it around the world,
No.
but or is it still gone entirely?
It's gone entirely. A lot of fans are hoping for the 50th they bring it back. Because that was in California, they had Paint the Night. That was their staple parade. The Main Street Electrical Parade was the staple parade for Magic Kingdom. Yeah, you had your parades during the day, but everybody wanted Main Street Electrical Parade at night.
Yeah, I mean, it is like a cult
Oh,
thing.
God, yeah.
Like that's why I was like, when I first was like there, I'm like, I don't know if I like this. Like, is this kind of weird?
I'll never forget when we took Jade when she was a kid, when I was down in Tampa, and it was the Main Street Electrical Parade. Now, I grew up with that in the 80s. Every night we were at Magic Kingdom, we had to stay for that parade. It was funny, me and one cast member were kind of dancing with the music in between the thing. We were doing like a little hoedown dance with it. The music, while it's so freaky, it's got a unique like beat where once you get it in your head, you can't get it out.
No. So, and obviously we do like the electrical parade.
Yeah, obviously.
But it is it's a fun thing. I think it nighttime at Disney lacks because of that. And at Magic Kingdom, it lacks because of that. When I went back and it wasn't there, it was kind of like, what do you do now? It was like a cool thing as like an interlude to lead up to the fireworks and everything. So, and it's also an opportunity when they have something like that, just like the fireworks. Do you need to see the fireworks? Say you're a person that goes to Magic Kingdom two or three times on your trip, or park hops, and you're there at night. Do you really need to see the fireworks three times? No. Do you really need to see the magical Main Street, the Main Street Electrical Parade? No, you don't have to. Great opportunity to go hit the rides.
Absolutely.
But if you're there, that's one thing you have to see at least once. Yeah, and it was. Is that gone forever? Who knows? They brought it back already. You said that, rumors are that they want to bring it, might bring it back for the 50th anniversary. That'd be great. I think they should bring it. I don't mind them resting it and bringing it back because it leads up to more hype and things like that, and it gets you more excited. But they need something else there.
Yeah, I agree. They need a nighttime parade. I can only imagine if they said, we are bringing it back for the 50th, that first night, opening night, I can only imagine the crowd on the parade route.
Oh
It's
yeah.
going to be insane. I guarantee you probably could walk on Seven Dwarfs Mine Train. The crowd will be immense for this parade.
I agree. I agree. All right, what you got next, man?
Good one. I was thinking you were going somewhere else. I actually thought you were going for this chain of events I got.
Oh.
Yeah. Okay. I'm actually going to start at the beginning. Magic Kingdom, 1971. Now, granted, I was not here in 71, but this is the history of this ride. All right. In 71, the ride was called Flight to the Moon. The ride concept was, it's kind of like a circle seating. You had a screen in the middle of the floor and a screen on the top. The whole concept was in this, you know, this was at the height of the Apollo missions, you know, rushing against the Russians to get to the moon. So in 1975, they actually changed it to Mission Mars, because in 69, we made it to the moon. The whole concept is you're on an Apollo rocket. The seats would kind of on hydraulics. The sides would go up and down, and kids with the imagination would be like, oh, my God, I can feel the G-forces. There were no G-forces. You weren't going nowhere. But kids, you can literally see, and I was one of them as a kid, holding on to the chair like, ugh. You could see it. And you would see different parts of the rocket ship coming off. You'd see the stars. And so in 69, oh, I'm sorry, in 1995, it was changed to, do you know, Josh?
I don't.
It was the extraterrestrial alien encounter.
Now, I was going to say that, but I thought that's where that was, and I wasn't sure. So
the concept was the same. He had the same seating. They just added some stuff to the seats. And, of course, a giant alien, a giant xenomorph in the middle. and then, of course, it changed to the ride that most people don't really like.
Yeah, no.
That's why when you were saying the last one, oh, it's kind of goofy and quirky. And then in 2003, it was changed to Stitch's Great Escape. All right, that ride, I rode it. Mission to Mars was way better than Great Escape. But then in 2018, they closed it. It's now a meet and greet for Stitch. They haven't said if they're replacing it with anything. But yeah, some history there. Mission Flight to the Moon, which became Mission to Mars, was a great ride. Great in Tomorrowland because it was all about space exploration. There was some education involved in the beginning. There was a little presentation of how rockets work and stuff like that. But yeah.
See, now I think those first two iterations of that ride would be perfect at Epcot. I know. Which surprised me they didn't retheme it even earlier. You know, because let's face it, Magic Kingdom is all about the intellectual property. It's about the characters. To have a ride that's not character based, it kind of doesn't really fit in at Magic Kingdom to me.
Well, they had several back in the day that way in Tomorrowland.
Well, yeah.
There was If I Had Wings, that was sponsored by Eastern Airlines, then Delta. That actually became Space Ranger Spin in that area. That ride was all about the Wright brothers and learning how to fly, that jets and stuff like that. Again, Omni Mover system for that. All you did was sit in a little buggy and it took you around. That was Tomorrowland back in the day. The only ride they had in Tomorrowland was Space Mountain. Everything else was more education.
Get that education out of Magic Kingdom. I'm teasing. I don't mind it slipped in a little. Now Stitches, what? Spate was Stitches
Great Escape.
Yeah, Great Escape. I went on it. I knew it wasn't a popular ride. We went once. Actually, went on twice. We did one because, again, it's a ride you can get on very quickly.
Air conditioning.
Yeah, it's air conditioned. It is not the greatest thing ever by far. I'll admit that. I think the best thing that the kids get out of it, honestly, is when they release the smell with the smell, the you know, because they think, oh, somebody farted in here, you know. Kids all laugh and get all, who are you? But yeah, I'm not sad that it's gone, but I think it's missed that there's one less attraction there. And maybe the older attractions, like you said, were clearly better
Oh,
than
yeah.
the Stitches, but
Yeah.
I can see why they rethemed it to Stitch because it's character based.
It's character
At
based.
that time, you know, with
Right.
Epcot now being established and everything, so.
And Lilo and Stitch at the time was big because remember, that's when they had
Yeah.
toilet paper, Cinderella's Castle.
Yep.
So I understood why they did it. But yeah, Mission to Mars was such a fun ride. Very little as far as ride-based excitement goes, more imagination-based.
Which is cool. I like that you had to use your imagination more.
Yep.
Okay, I got one more.
Okay.
Okay, going to Epcot. Okay, and with all the changes going on at Epcot in the Future World section, they tore down a lot, and you know, it's kind of crazy with all the construction going on. So I'm very excited to see what they're going to do there. But one place that I liked to go to when it was really hot out and you can cool off and you can have a refreshment or seven or eight or so, and it would not cost you a dime.
Oh, were you having Beverly?
No.
But am I at the right spot? Am I at the right spot?
You are at Club Cool, yes. So this isn't a ride. It's not really an attraction, but it was something that did not cost you a dime unless you wanted to purchase something. It was basically a Coca-Cola shop. Okay. But what they had were different sodas from around the world. So you had like seven or eight countries and what their most popular soda was. And it was tucked. It was kind of like towards the end of Future World. You're heading towards the World Showcase, that walkway. So if you spent the morning in Future World, and you're kind of like, oh, I'm gonna go up to the showcase for lunch, which we always highly recommend. Let me get a drink. I'm kind of thirsty. I've been here for 2.5, 3 hours. Let's go get something to drink. I would have recommended going there or at the end of the day or something. Maybe you're left early for some unknown reason. It was hot. Whatever you were there, you could go there and get a soda. Now, they were sample cups. They're not that big. Now, the whole thing was you weren't supposed to spend an hour there. Okay. But it was plenty of people coming in and out that you could kind of blend in a little. And let me tell you, I had more than enough on more than one occasion that I should have probably been kicked out. And they said, you know what? Maybe you should leave. But some of the flavors, phenomenal. You had from Brazil, Japan, Thailand, South America, Peru, Italy, Greece, and Zimbabwe. Okay. So they took the most popular flavors. Brazil had a guarana berry type soda that was pretty sweet, but was very good. Japan had a Vegeta Beta, which was an apricot and passion fruit, which was very refreshing. South Africa, I really liked. It was called Bibo or Bibo, Bibo. It was just a fruity drink. I couldn't pinpoint it. People describe it in many different ways, but again, really refreshing. Peru had the Inca Kola, which you can find in certain stores. That's like a bubblegum cola, which had like it was weird, but still very refreshing. Fanta is a huge soda company. I believe it's part of Coca-Cola, obviously. And I think that's what the Brazil soda was, a Fanta brand. But Greece, they love Fanta pineapple there, I guess. That was what's picked for them. Zimbabwe had a raspberry cream called Sparberry. That was fantastic. That was really good. Which leads me to what everybody would try. And yes,
Oh.
I knew about it and I tried it. It was one of the worst things I've ever tasted in my life, right up there along with liver and onions.
Oh no, I think I'd eat liver and onions before I'd drink that.
If someone gave me a plate of liver and onions and a glass of, now this Italian beverage is called Beverly. Such a sweet name. You think, oh, Beverly. You think of like,
An old lady,
and then
growing.
again, the older woman next door that would bake you cookies, you know, would always remember your birthday. Every once in a while, I might say, don't step on my flowers as you're running through the yard to go meet your friends. No, Beverly is a nasty old woman. And she's very,
Whoa.
very bitter, which is what this soda is. Why soda's bitter? I don't know. I don't know. I don't get it. If you gave me liver and onions and a Beverly, I would tell you all the deepest, darkest secrets of my life if you made me eat that. Like just to not eat it, like and drink it. It's terrible. So
I rank Beverly up there with if you'd go to the gym, play basketball, play baseball, run around, play football, take the socks and wring it out, that's Beverly. Woo!
I'm glad they had it there, because watching people's expressions when they tasted it, for those that did not know, I
Yeah.
had a clue going into it, but I'm very open-minded when it comes to tasting new foods and drinks. I'm like, I gotta try this. There were people gagging, people spitting it out in the garbage can.
Oh, yeah.
It is terrible. When my kid had it, it was the funniest thing. I have it on video somewhere. I have to put it up so you guys can see it. It is, he's like, I'm gonna do it. And he's just, I mean, it is, and he tried it more than once just to see if he kept torturing himself. I don't know why. Even to this day, he's like, I will never drink that But I thought that was a great spot. It didn't cost you a dime. And even if you were there for a while, they have cast members that are cleaning up because people were not nice and would drop their cups. They would do, you know, they would leave cups around. So they always have great cleanup crew there. The one cast member knew we were there for at least 25 minutes or more, and they didn't care. I just like, oh, how you doing? Where are you from? You know, just talking and blah blah blah. You talk to cast members like that, you're gonna get away with a little bit more. But I missed it because, again, it's free. It was a great place to cool off. You had air conditioning. You had enough sugar to make the hike to wherever your lunch was at World Showcase. And I thought it was like a cool thank you. You know, what Coke paid to be there, but it was just an extra gimme, you know. However, if you do miss some of these, you can go to Disney Springs to the Coca-Cola rooftop bar, and you can get a flight of different sodas from around the world. And I think they rotate it more there. I think they still have the Beverly there.
They should have a challenge. Can you drink a flight of Beverly's?
Oh, yeah. Can you drink just a 12-ounce can of it?
Without throwing up.
Yeah, without gagging, without, yeah. So I think they have little light dishes there you can eat. They also have at the rooftop bar, you can get like a larger Coca-Cola bottle. It's $8 for the bottle, $3.25 for your first fill of whatever soda they have there. And if you bring it back, it's only a dollar for an extra fill. So not a bad deal. So at least they kind of have another option for you if you really wanted to taste those sodas from around the world. This time you got to pay for it, but you are getting more. You're not just getting a little sample cup, but I'll miss that place. Not the Beverly. So that's what I got for some things that I miss around Walt Disney World.
Those are some good picks.
All right. Are we done?
We are done.
Wow. You did three?
I did three.
See, time flies when you're having fun.
Yeah. You just messed it up with Beverly. That's all. Brought back hard.
We're all just like, even just thinking about it, you're just kind of like, oh. Yeah. It like, it messes with your mind even.
Yes.
So let us know. I want to know if anybody out there honestly, truly liked that drink. I talked to someone from work who is from Italy and goes back to Italy often. And they're like, oh, no. No, no, no. No, no, no. They don't even like it. I guess it takes a certain person to enjoy that beverage. But I don't know. Let us know if you're that certain person. And what do you miss? What was taken away from your childhood, from your kids' childhood experiences at Walt Disney World? What's been taken away and replaced by something or not replaced? Let us know. Drop a comment below. Let us know on our Facebook page. Now we'll put that question up to you guys. We'll do a Twitter poll maybe. What do you miss most? So let us know. There's lots of things that they've taken away from us. But they've also given us so much. So, you know. Let us know. So you can reach us on all of our social media outlets, including here at YouTube, Facebook, Instagram. Just search the Magical Main Street Dads. We're there. Facebook is taking off. How many followers we got now?
Followers were over 155.
Very good. So thank you for your support there. If you're on our Facebook page, you know, hop over to Instagram, hop over to Twitter, you know, watch the videos. It's not just Facebook postings that we do. We try to hit everything. So get involved, ask us questions, talk to us through those media outlets. Twitter is Magic Main ST Dads. Just keep a lookout for what we're posting on those. So I think that's it for this round. We're going to come up with another interesting topic. But if you guys have a topic that you want us to cover, let us know too. And we'll be more than happy to talk about it, field your questions, and get you involved in on it too. So I think that's it for this round, dude.
Yep, we're good, man.
All right, dude. So until next time, be safe, be happy. Later.
See ya.
Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, Disneyland proudly presents our spectacular festival pageant of nighttime magic and imagination. In thousands of sparkling lights and electro-symphomagnetic musical sounds, the Main Street Electrical Parade.